Oops, sorry about that. It does that sometimes. So, I'm Arabella DeLuco, the CEO of eXceL, and what we do is we champion diverse people from untapped communities by elevating their stories and giving them key tools to succeed. Today, I am super excited for our guest. She is a filmmaker and has an incredible documentary that is an official selection of Sundance 2020, Shalini Kantayya. Shalini, welcome to the show. Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, thanks so much for having me. It's an honor.
Yay. So I want to talk to you about yourself and how you got to be where you are today. It's an incredible story. And then I'll go ahead and also show the coded bias trailer so we can get excited for our WeXL special screening in September. But first, tell us about you.
Well, I think all of my work has to do with disruptive technology. I sort of like tech. I like sci-fi. I like imagining the future of tech. And sort of all my films, in some way or another, examine how tech makes the world more or less fair, particularly for the marginalized. So that's kind of the commonality in all my work.
So, is that something that you just kind of figured? Like, how did you figure that was something of interest to you? Because that's pretty niche as a filmmaker to realize that
Well,
this is my focus.
it's more like you look back on your body of work, and I did like a sci-fi that was about a woman who goes to India to put prepaid credit cards on a village water pump, and then I did a film called Catching the Sun that is about unemployed workers trying to get jobs in the solar industry and sort of the economic promise of small scale solar for working people. And then I sort of I came across the work of Joy Boulamwini and the author of Weapons of Mass Destruction, Kathy O'Neill, and sort of fell down the rabbit hole in thinking about sort of the dark side of big tech.
Very interesting. And you also love sci-fi, right? So even though the film that we're talking about today is coded bias, it's a documentary, are you planning on doing sci-fi films, narrative films?
I am actually working on something now, but my first priority in the moment is to get coded bias the biggest release possible.
Yeah, absolutely. And so tell us about how you became a filmmaker in the first place. Like, what was that journey like?
I just fell in love with images, quite literally, and had the experience of seeing the world in a new way. I was in India, which is quite a visually arresting place, and then started to make small films and was really bad at it, and but kept making it and had this passion that just kind of wouldn't leave me. And that's kind of how each film is. It sort of slowly takes over my life.
I think it's so cool that you would say, I was really bad at it, but I just kept making them.
Well, it's true. I feel like people who make films don't have any choice but to make films. And I feel that very much about this, that it feels very much like fallen, and I don't know what else I would be doing with my life if I weren't.
They say that, you know, if you want to make movies, just make your first movie and get it out of the way.
Yes, because I mean, no one is born Scorsese. I feel like all of these skills are learned over time. I feel like it's like it, that filmmaking is like anything else that way. You just need to do the time.
So, did you study filmmaking at all?
I did. I do have a master's in filmmaking, but most of what I learned, I went back to study narrative filmmaking because I had been working in documentary, and I really love both mediums very much. But I think my first love might be sci-fi.
Yeah, and I think it's super cool. I love sci-fi, I love fantasy, and I love the stories that you can, the truth you can tell through those stories, even if they are fictionalized. And what I found interesting about Coded Bias is that it's not sci-fi. It's really the truth, but there were remnants of, well, not remnants, there were things in it that felt very much sci-fi. And did that, was that part of the reason why you were drawn to the story itself?
Well, I think there's just always been this, what I discovered in making Coded Bias is that from the beginning, there's been this interplay between AI researchers and sci-fi writers. And I think for us, a lot of our thinking about AI comes from science fiction. It comes from Philip K. Dick, Blade Runner, and The Minority Report, and all of these things that sort of give us a framework. And I think the challenge of making Coded Bias was trying to make these invisible systems visible. And so I sort of played with these tropes of science fiction to give us a way of understanding the AI of the now.
Mm. I see. And do you think that it's so funny enough, Siri just came up on my computer, even though it's like, even though I told her not to disturb me. Do you find that this is only going to get scarier if we don't do something about it now?
This technology is sort of more powerful than I ever imagined. I think that I think I had heard the word privacy, but it didn't quite register the depth of the kind of invasive surveillance, the kind of data that a company like Google or Facebook has about us, and how they can predict our behavior. And I think that it's just time that we have some legislation and some rights as citizens to the power of big tech, especially now that we've all become so reliant on these technologies, even more reliant since COVID. And sometimes I feel like there's a danger. I mean, what I learned in the making of this film was that there is an incredible danger in the fact that AI has become this invisible gatekeeper, deciding who gets hired, who gets healthcare, who, you know, how long a prison sentence someone serves, even who gets undue police scrutiny by technologies like facial recognition. And yet technologies that are racially biased, like what's so crazy is that this technology that was already being deployed by law enforcement was proven racially biased and to have gender bias. And somehow these large multinational corporations missed it. And that says something about how big the blind spot is in terms of the kinds of harms that these technologies could cause without some oversight of someone in an elected office. And so I really think that that's, and to do that, we sort of have to understand science. We've seen with climate change and with COVID that like there's this incredible importance on understanding the science that touches our lives and having good communicators. And with algorithmic justice, we're just at the beginning of understanding how data rights impacts our civil rights. And so I hope people will watch this film and share it and talk about it and try to take some sort of local action so that we push companies to be in check with our democratic values.
Yes, and you know, there's actually a question from one of our viewers. They asked, do you get pushback from the industries when you cover topics like that in coded bias?
Well, we haven't had any targeted screenings at the industry. I hope to in the future at the film thing. But I can tell you, I had the benefit and the good fortune to have had a real audience screening at Sundance in 2020, and which seems incredible now to have had it, to have seen the film with an audience. But there were some tech people who came up to me and loved the film, and I think the people who are making these decisions are not bad people. We all have unconscious bias. And so, but they do need, you know, other people in the room, ethicists in the room. The power of this kind of decision making shouldn't just be with a few tech guys, mostly.
I know that there's some, I think that there's like concern that maybe it'll make the technology sector look bad. But to me, I thought the film is something that is, has to be, even if it's uncomfortable for the people who are building the technology. And, you know, we understand that a lot of developers, a lot of software engineers developing these products are, they're in homogenous teams, mostly white male dominated teams. And it is an uncomfortable conversation to have, that the people who are, you know, you're thinking about technology, and I know for sure in the startup industry, usually you start with such a small team that it'll be homogenous usually. And so how do you start testing something that is, you know, for mass consumption in a way that is more equitable, if your team is really small? But for these large companies, it's really like that sort of a good push for diversity within their team. And which brings me back to the documentary itself. I love how most of your experts speaking are women. It was, and I think that was so enlightening and powerful for me as a woman who has worked in the tech industry. How did you plan? Or did you plan on that, or did you just end up finding women experts to speak on the topic?
It's so interesting that everyone comments on that, because I think the gender ratios are about the same of most AI. They're just films, it's just sort of flipped. And I think that what I found is that women are leading this conversation about bias in tech. They women are leading the conversation about ethics in tech, dare I say it. And so I found in the making of this film that most of the brilliant and badass people leading this movement were women. And so it ended up being that. But I also think that it does shine light on who's in the room when these decisions are made, because I think it's in the film 14% of AI researchers are women, and that's astounding. We're thrilled to partner with organizations like Anita B that are pushing for more inclusion in tech and more.
That gives me chills. That's so cool.
Yes, exactly. I think, you know, celebrating that and knowing that inclusion isn't about, you know, having better looking pictures, but also about, you know, being innovative, being competitive in the industries of the future. If you're having technologies that are just deployed on everyone, you know? And the other thing is just having some legislation so that the power of big tech isn't so unchecked, because what I began to see is basically every civil right that we enjoy as citizens of a democracy dovetails with data rights. And the more I hope that the film sparks conversation around that and how we can build more human-centered technologies that work for more of us.
Yeah, that is incredible. And yes, what a great year to be pushing for better legislation around this particular topic, right? It's presidential election year. Also, we had a guest yesterday who is a young product designer from Venezuela, and her name is Aura Escobar, and she was also talking about designing products that's human-centered, that with the actual user in mind, to create more inclusive sensory experiences with the product itself, and really having that sort of focus on the user themselves. I have another question for you from the internets. What has it been like to release a film like this in 2020 specifically? Does it make it more or less relevant?
Oh, that was a wonderful question. I thank you for that. I think that the film showed at Sundance, and I was sort of ready to put it on ice. South by Southwest didn't happen. We were slated to play there. And then I was ready to sort of put it on ice. And then we played at the New York Human Rights Watch Film Festival in June. And I feel like I owe a debt of gratitude to people in the streets fighting for the inherent value of Black life and a bigger framework for human rights for all of us, because I think that the protests really changed the way the film was seen and added urgency to this look at how making sure that we do not replicate the injustices of the past as we move forward into the 21st century, that we learn from the inequalities and the mistakes that we made in the past. And so I think that the film has really had this upsurge in interest, I think, since June and since the protests, and I've barely been able to keep up with the demand for people to screen it. And we're excited to share the film finally.
Yeah, it's almost like when COVID happened, I felt the same way. People were asking me, do people really care about diversity now that there's this pandemic? And I said, well, they should always care about diversity and equity and inclusion. It's not, you know, it's an ongoing thing. And then, unfortunately what happened was, you know, it did come up. And when something like a pandemic, a global event happens like this, it only shines a light to the inequities that are happening in the world that continue to happen, even if it's not something that the media or people choose to shine light on until something, you know, blows up, right?
Well, I think what was incredible, what I saw was sea change that I never thought I could imagine at the beginning of the making of this film, which is that IBM said that they would get out of the facial recognition game. They would not research it, deploy it, or sell it. Microsoft said they would stop selling it to police, and Amazon said it would put a one-year pause. And that happened in June of this year. And I think that sea change happened because of brave researchers like the ones in my film, Joy Bolognini, Nick Gebru, and Deborah Raji, for their groundbreaking research, for having such confidence in the scientific method that they could stand up against big companies, and also explain why this science matters, that the bias of this of these technologies matters, and who it matters most to. So I feel like I saw what brave scientists in working with engaged citizens on the street who are pushing for a future, the impact it can have on a massive company we never imagined. But at the same time, I hope it will not be up to these big technologies to pick up and put down these kinds of powerful invasive surveillance tools without some laws in place.
So you bring something up. Why do you think it's necessary to explain that this matters, that looking at biases and technology matters?
Because basically, I mean, you can see quite without any, there's this direct line between protecting Black life and banning facial recognition. To me, those things are this very deeply aligned. Just encoded bias, one of the most kind of terrifying things that the audience witnesses is a 14-year-old boy, a Black child in school uniform, getting stopped by five police officers because of facial recognition technology misidentified them. Here in the US, a man was falsely arrested in front of his family and his neighbors and held for 30 hours and never asked for his ID because of a facial recognition misidentification. And so this has real impacts for communities of color and Black communities first, and also, just for policing and law enforcement, and as we're having this national conversation. And, you know, there was a moment in the film where Jim Jordan, who's a Republican, says, wait a minute, 117 million Americans are in a facial recognition database and there's no one in an elected office that said this was okay. And we should all be scared about law enforcement, corporations selling directly to law enforcement with nobody in an elected office saying it's okay and having any rules around this. And the same thing has to happen with corporations. You know, they shouldn't be able to just use our faces and any other parts of our data how they choose. We should have some rights.
Yeah, and so there's still that awareness that needs to happen. And someone else on the chat, Mike Didi, asked, can you speak a bit about the specific policy proposals in the legislation you mentioned?
Well, there's the one that I know about is basically there is a federal moratorium on the federal law enforcement use of facial recognition, which would be the ICE, the FBI, would not extend to law in, to police departments. And that was just proposed, I believe, by a representative, Ayanna Presley of Massachusetts, I believe. So that's on the table as of June, and we can all put pressure for that to go through, but that will protect us from, say, corporations or other things. There's also, on if you go to codedbias.com/take action, there's a number of things that you can do on the site with our partnerships at the ACLU and Mijente and others that are doing such great work on these issues.
Yeah, and he asked another question, which I think when I watched this film, I thought it was interesting when someone said on, one of the experts said that we're creating, you know, machine learning on data that is already biased. And so Mike Didi asks also, how do we get about creating training data for algorithms that is free of implicit biases that reinforce systemic inequality? So I thought that is pretty much, it's answered a bit in the
documentary. Yeah, that's a great question. That's an Ask an MIT Media Lab researcher question about unbiased data sets. But what I will do is say, even, you know, eradicating bias is one thing, but the other thing is, even if they work perfectly, you don't want to make invasive surveillance perfect. That can have its own problems, you know, just even if the technology works perfectly. And so we do need rules. Bias is just part of the issue. We also should be concerned with fairness and quality and of other values in these technologies,
which is why the discussion on ethics and in building these products will be ongoing. And before we bring on our VIP audience member Ian Storer, I wanted to show the trailer of it, and also tell people we eXceL is doing a very special screening of Coded Bias the first week in September, where we'll be having a Twine mixer after. And Twine is a new startup based out of New York City that brings together people one-on-one for meaningful conversations. So I'm really excited that we're going to have the screening, and then you can have a conversation with someone who is interested in the film, but you've never met before, and it's all going to be a nice experience. So, and a little bit different than the usual Zoom conferences that you're used to. So let's show the Coded Bias trailer, and we'll be right back. One second, just sharing the screen, like always. Okay. Oops.
During my first semester at MIT, I got computer vision software that was supposed to track my face. It didn't work until I put on this white mask. I'm thinking, all right, what's going on here? Is it the lighting conditions? Is it the angle at which I'm looking at the camera? Or is there something more? That's when I started looking into issues of bias that can creep into technology.
Our ideas about technology that we think are normal are actually ideas that come from a very small and homogeneous group of people.
Vast amounts of data at incredible speeds.
Everybody has unconscious biases, and people embed their own biases into technology.
This kid got stopped
as a result of facial recognition misidentification.
And then used that as justification to search you.
This is an innocent child.
Racism is becoming mechanized.
Systemic issues are only going to be hardwired into new technologies.
It's not just face classification, it's any data-centric technology.
Every day, we are all being scored.
Who gets hired? Who gets housing?
I am making predictions for your life right now.
The people who own the code deploy it on other people, and there is no accountability.
Management Analytic Towers wanted to install the facial recognition software.
Pretty much turn this place into Fort Knox.
The technology is being rapidly adopted, and there are no safeguards.
We are socially controlled in a way that we don't see.
Technology that analyzes faces could be biased, but the company is pushing it anyway.
What demographic is it most effective on?
White men.
Show me that it's going to be fair, that it's legal, before you put it out. That's what we don't have yet.
It's going to take people coming together, striving for justice in this age of automation.
All right, so I'm getting a lot of people excited on the chat box. They're very excited for this screening. Oh my goodness, I'm so sorry about that. One second. Okay, whew, sorry about that. It just kept on playing that YouTube. Okay, so I want to, Shalini, before I open it up to our VIP audience guests today, is there anything that you want to talk about? I love that trailer. That was really cool. Who was your editor for the trailer? Did you do that yourself or did you have someone edit it?
Wheelhouse. That was Wheelhouse that did that trailer.
Wheelhouse, it's so incredible. It does have that like Minority Report feel too. Super, super cool. It gives me chills. And it says, so a bunch of people are just saying, looking forward to the screening. This looks so good. Wow, so powerful for the time we are in right now. And so before we open it up to our VIP attendee today, audience member, I wanted to let you know about WeXcel's new program called, membership, actually. It's a new membership. It's a way for you to contribute a tax donation to WeXcel. We are a 501c3 nonprofit, $60 for the whole year. And what you do is, what we give you is you get access to our VIP audience lounge online on here. So you can actually be part of the webcast. So I will have Ian come on here. We'll promote to panelists. Ian, you can, I think you're on and you can actually also start video.
Hi.
Hi, and Shalini. I don't know. I think your video got, oh, there you go. Yes. So thank you so much, Ian, for joining us as our very first VIP audience member. Well, actually, Whitney was the very first one last week, but we had to finagle a few things. But now we are locked and loaded. So do you have any questions for Shalini that I haven't asked yet?
Yeah, I guess, I mean, the trailer was amazing, chilling. So I look forward to seeing the whole thing. But I'm just wondering, we have all these, you know, movies, TV shows, and other things that have kind of warned us about some of this stuff, Minority Report, whatever it is. How do we do more to educate people for them to understand, other than watching your documentary? But I don't think that it's just going to be one documentary. I think we need to change the narrative or maybe increase people's awareness of these problems systemically.
Yes. There are a number of resources on the website, codedbias.com/takeaction. And there actually is a reading list of a whole bunch of books and some articles and some of the foremost scholars in the field, because I do think the first step is just getting educated.
Sure. But do you see people making films and TV shows and or writing and kind of picking up the theme and kind of helping to do that work? Or is that still kind of just you and...
No, absolutely. I do feel like the national dialogue is, I feel like we're on the crust of like a big game change in the national dialogue.
Very cool.
Yeah, and Shalini, what was the most challenging thing that when you were making this particular film for you?
All of it, raising money. It's like a startup. Making films like a startup. And I do a lot myself. I do a lot myself. with a very small, very talented team that I've been working with for years. I have great working relationships with them. And so, but I think, one, it was just very difficult to tell a story for which had never been told. I'd never seen a film about algorithmic bias before. And a lot of times I couldn't even explain it to people. I like didn't talk to people at parties for like 2 years because I couldn't explain what I was making a film about. I would be like, well, I'm kind of making a film about racist robots and how machines can encode our bias. But it was very hard to explain. And then in the film itself, I think, you know, connecting science to stories of why the science matters. I think those two things were difficult and took some journalistic, it took a little journalistic of a push to find those stories, because, you know, sometimes you're discriminated against by an algorithm and you don't even know it. You never know when you've been filtered out of this first line of decision-making by an AI. You know, finding these people who could prove that and actually had cases pending, that took a lot of work, and I relied on a lot of research that was done before me by journalists and writers.
So you said it's about 2 years of development that you...
2 years, which is actually short for an independent documentary, actually.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I don't think 2 years is a long time at all. I'm pretty surprised you did all of this in 2 years.
Sundance premiere, yeah, exactly. It was fast. It was fast for us.
How did you meet Joy?
I saw her work and I wrote her a letter, I think, more than once. And then... sort of said, hey, let's just meet and do one shoot and we can talk later about the details of everything. And did one shoot and went from there.
That's incredible. Ian, you have another question, right?
Yeah, so you're talking about the way that technology can be used in biased ways by the police or by other people in authority. What about on the criminal side? Is that a part of the work you've looked at, people using AI or something to target people and find people that are more vulnerable, whether because of age or race or gender or something, and, you know, get them involved in something, some kind of con or something like that?
Yeah, I mean, it happens on two things. It happens in terms of racial bias, in technologies like facial recognition that become sort of the new stop and frisk, essentially. And we know the disparate impacts that has on communities of color. Or it happens to someone like LaTanya Myers in my film, who had an algorithm decide that she was high risk, even though she had basically honors from the city council and the mayor for her work on criminal justice, and she had been out of jail. And so and the algorithm had more authority than the probation officer and the judge. And that's crazy. That's just insanity. And so we have to look at how we're employing these technologies and the invisible. I think why this is so dangerous is that it can be so invisible, it can be so opaque to us, and it can roll back things that we fought for, you know, fair housing, fair employment, you know, lots of civil rights gains can be eroded without us knowing. And so it's really important that we understand how these work and get lawmakers involved in regulating these technologies.
And do you have anything right now that you know of? I know on your website, codedbias.com, you had this, you know, kind of action, recommended action steps, which I thought was really cool, because obviously you watch this documentary and if you're compelled to do something about it, you know, you can, and I like that you made that easy. Do you know of anything that is any policy that's being created now because of this movie by any chance, or any sort of action steps?
Yeah, we hope to have some exciting announcements with our national theatrical release, November 11th in New York. And so we hope to have some big announcements then, and we definitely want to challenge we want to challenge whoever is elected in November to engage with these issues.
Whoa, that's a big deal. November 11th for a theatrical release. That's really cool. I hope that we can watch it in the theaters.
Yes.
By then.
It'll be a virtual theatrical, so hopefully you'll.
Oh, it's virtual. Okay, definitely virtual.
Yes. Many theaters are virtual now.
It's crazy how it's been changing. Before we end, we have about 5 more minutes, but I wanted to talk to you about future plans and maybe any sort of advice to young filmmakers, particularly women of color who are or girls of color who are out there looking up to you. I know I'm looking up to you. Future advice? No, I know it's a
I think women of color hold up the sky. I am just cheering you on. And the only thing I can say is, like, don't give up. Because that is the thing. Like, it's not how many times you fall down, it's how many times you get up. And there's the thing that I think I make films because I realize, and particularly the power of documentaries, you realize that everyday people have these heroic qualities and you get to shine a light on that. And I think I make films to remember that a small group of people can make a difference. And I'm not just being sentimental here. Like, I watched that happen in the making of this film. Three women, including Joy, really game changed the industry because of their bravery and because of the integrity of their science. And so of their practice as scientists. And so that's the only thing is, like, don't give up, because that's the only thing that will stop you.
That's really wonderful and empowering. And it's super cool too, because the reason why we even have you on here is because my friend Megan Adele Lopez is part of your team in promoting Coded Bias. And also, prior to this, without even me knowing that Megan was involved with this film, I saw a little tweet from her feed the day before one of our earlier shows with Natalie Hall, who's a producer in London. And we were talking about these sort of technology biases because she experienced it herself while putting up a Facebook ad, and it was flagging her, you know, flagging BIPOC artists, particularly actually Black and African or Black artists on her ad, saying that it may not be, it may be questionable content. But when she put a white artist on there, it didn't flag her. So when I was researching before the show to talk about this sort of bias in the facial recognition, I found Megan's tweet and I said, what is this coded bias? it is such an incredible connection. And then I didn't even talk to Megan before the show happened. I just posted it online, right? And then Megan's like, hey, did you know that I'm working on this film? I'm like, what? I think it's incredible.
Thank you. Well, Joy calls it the coded gaze. We used to talk about film and television and the gaze of that, sort of the white male gaze in film and television. And now what Joy and others have taught us is that technology also has a white male gaze.
Yes, unfortunately, and we're hoping to make that more of a rainbow than how it's been. So, and thank you for your work, for continuing
to
do
that.
Thank
you, guys. Thank you so much.
I really appreciate you. Ian says thank you. I don't know if he wants to say thank you himself, but he wrote that down. And we're very excited to screen this first week in September. Please come back. If you're watching this on YouTube, please subscribe, like, you know the deal. Thank you so much. Thank you, Shalini. Thank you, Ian, for joining us. Thank you, audience. And goodbye until tomorrow. We have Kenyatta Wright, who is an entrepreneur from New York City. So bye for now.